Okay, let's get started. So I want to let people know that if you have questions, please ask them in the chat, and then at the end of the session, I'll read them off, and hopefully Vincent will be able to answer them for you. And then let me introduce Vincent from Sisterel.
Okay, thank you very much. Have you started the recording? I can go?
Yep.
Yep, okay. So welcome everyone to this presentation named Using OPC UA with Zifra. About the agenda, first we're going to introduce the OPC UA protocol for those of you who are not familiar with it. Next, we're going to explain how you can deploy the OPC UA protocol on Zephyr using S2OPC product. And last but not least, we're going to see how you can perform continuous integration of S2OPC on Zephyr using Renode. About the OPC UA protocol, so OPC UA is a machine-to-machine and IIoT communication protocol, which is service-oriented. It is an international standard since 2008. It is registered as the IEC 62541. It includes natively some cybersecurity feature. It is not an add-on on the protocol. The protocol is open and interoperable, and it is multi-platform. It can run on Linux, Windows, Zephyr, as opposed to its ancestor, some of you may know, which was OPC DA, and OPC DA was only available on Windows because it used the COM-DCOM mechanism. That's not the case with OPC UA, which is multi-platform. The OPC UA protocol is managed by an organism named the OPC Foundation. You can see at the right the number of members of the OPC Foundation over the year. So it's highly increasing over the year. Now there are about more than 800 members at the OPC Foundation. The OPC Foundation is in charge of the OPC UA development and promotion. And the foundation is also in charge of the certification of your product. If you claim that your product is interoperable, is OPC UA interoperable, you must go to the neutral compliance lab and pass the certification test. And if you pass all these functional robustness tests, you get a certificate claiming your interoperability. So that's why the protocol is highly interoperable. Thanks to all these good properties, the OPC UA protocol is recommended by all leading industrial consortia around the world, whereas it is USA, Europe, China, and so on and so forth. The protocol includes some cybersecurity features. It ensures the confidentiality of the message using encryption. It checks the integrity and authenticity of the messages using signature on the messages. It includes some mechanism, for example, to control the message size and to avoid some type of attacks, and to ensure the availability of the protocol. There are several authentication levels in the protocol. You have authentication level at the application level based on X509 certificate, but you also have an authentication mechanism at the user level using user password or also certificates. In addition to that, you can define some access rights to authorize or forbid operation to everyone or some users. Last but not least, the protocol ensures that it's written in the specification that you must log some audit events for to be able to perform audit on cybersecurity of all cybersecurity events on your platform. The BSI has performed an in-depth analysis on the protocol, and they have concluded that there is no systematic error in the specification. It is cybersecurity ready. The protocol is also safe. That's new. Since the 1.05 revision of the protocol, there is a new part in the OPC UA specification, which is now named OPC UA Safety. So in this, the gray part at the bottom of this picture, you can see the scope of existing OPC UA stack here. And in yellow here at the top, the OPC UA specification part 15 defines a new module named OPC UA Safety, which can be used on top to perform some functional safety ready communication up to SIL 3 according to 61508. The OPC UA Foundation is developing an open source module which will be available next year to perform this OPC UA safety mechanism. And if you want to plug this module on top of an existing OPC UA stack, you need to develop only this small gray part named the OPC UA mapper, which is more or less a glue between the safety part and the non-safe functional safety part. This is the principle of the black channel. You have a cybersecurity ready communication channel, and inside this channel, you communicate some data according to a functional safety protocol, and you separate the non-functional safety part in gray and the functional safety part in yellow. So at the end of the day, you have a safe and secure communication protocol. There are a lot of OPC UA users around the world. Of course, it is widespread in industry, whereas it on devices, on PLCs, on SCADA, in the cloud, but it is also used in other domains, such as the railway, for example, where there are a lot of gateways between the transit equipment and the SCADA, in the energy, and so on and so forth. According to the study, in 2018, there were about 40,000 million of automation devices with OPC UA client technology, OPC UA client only. That means for all OPC UA protocol as a whole, more than 100 million devices are already available around the world. So regarding the OPC UA protocol, you have two kinds of communication mechanism. One, the first one is a classic one, I would say. It's a client-server protocol. You have an OPC UA server, which organizes some data in a database called the address space. And at the other end, you have an OPC UA client, which connect to the server to perform some operation, to call some services, to read this data, to write this data, to browse into the address page, change its organization. It can subscribe to the modification to this data. It can call remote procedure call on this address space. So it's a one-to-one communication over TCP/IP. Since the revision 1.04 of the UPC UA protocol, you have another mechanism, which is the PubSub. It is different from the subscription mechanism of the client-server part. It is not an UPC, what we call an UPC UA service. The service is called on top of the client-server part. So you do not have client or server anymore. You have some publisher which publish some data, and you have some subscriber which subscribe to the data they are interested into. So it is a not connected communication protocol, which can be one-to-many instead of one-to-one. And with this publication of data, you giving the transport layer, which is an underlying layer, you can use a broker to dispatch the messages, or it can be brokerless. There are several transport layers which are available in the specification. You have UDP, Raw Ethernet, AMQP, or MQTT. So, for instance, on Zephyr, you will see that we have deployed the OPC UA PubSub UDP, which is brokerless. We use, instead of a broker such as on MQTT, the UDP multicast mechanism to dispatch the messages to equipment which has subscribed to the modification. The OPC UA PubSub implementation is lightweight compared to the client server part. It is use less resources. It is less resource consuming, I would say. A few words about S2OPC. So S2OPC is an OPC UA implementation, which is designed from scratch for certification. The first certification we obtained 18 months ago was the OPC UA certification. Now we have a CSPN. We have a CSPN certification, which is in progress. And next, we will target the common criteria cybersecurity certification. The product is designed to be scalable with high performance and able to meet real-time requirements. It is multi-platform. It runs on Linux, Windows, VxWorks, FreeRTOS, and of course, Zephyr. This S2OPC is fully open source. The full development is available in a transparent way on the GitLab, and the associated license is Apache 2.0. So non-contaminating, no copyleft, protection against patent claim, and so on and so forth. Now, if we focus on Zephyr. So why Zephyr? S2OPC and Zephyr, they have some characteristics in common. They have the same open source license, which is Apache 2.0. Both are built with safety and security in mind, and both target embedded system. That's why for Sisterel, porting S2OPC on Zephyr, it makes perfect sense. So about the current status of the porting of S2OPC on Zephyr, you can have a look on the associated issue on the GitHub, which is open. For now, we have ported two applications, but one of them contains only an OPC UA server. The second one contains both an OPC UA server and publisher subscriber. It is available on three different platforms, The first one is IMX 1064 from MXP. The second one is a SAM-A70 from Microchip. And the first one is native POSIX. I will explain later why we have this reduced number of platforms. Of course, in this deployment, we have deployed the cybersecurity. For instance, we have several security policies which are available both for the client server and for the pub sub part. During the porting activity, we have identified two main issues. One has been fixed, it was a risk of the SEC fault. The second one is still under discussion. It is linked to the POSIX API to access to the RTC, because as we need to check the date of the certificate, at one time we need to access to the current date. So we try to identify one API to perform this feature. And we have suggested two contributions. The two of them are related to our main issue during the porting, which was UDP multicast, because it is not, I would say, widely used feature of the UDP. And on the 2.3 revision of Zephyr, we have used the UDP multicast was not, I would say, working as expected. We have suggested one generic fix at the emission part, which was on the generic part, which has been accepted. The second fix, unfortunately, is hardware dependent. That means that every hardware provider needs to apply a fix in order to allow the UDP multicast mechanism to work properly. That's why we have a reduced number of targets, because for now, for every target we want to deploy the OPCU EPUB sub over UDP, we need to apply a patch on top of Zephyr in order to have the UDP multicast say the subscription part working as expected, but it's a work in progress. If you want to test the port, the S2PC team maintains on the GitLab dedicated Zephyr branch. You can see the instruction on the wiki of S2OPC. In short, there are five different steps. The first one is that you need to declare S2OPC as a Zephyr module in west.yaml. Next, of course, you need to update your packages. Next, you compile one demo application using West. You flash and start the application. And for example, if you have chosen the OPCUA PubSub server, the application will first expose a server on and its endpoints on the IP address of the boards and the port number 4841. And on Wireshark, you will see that the board will publicly send some OPCUA UDP PubSub messages. Here you can see the output on the terminal. That was the status after the porting activity. Now, one can say, how we are going to maintain this branch? Because on, for instance, on Linux, on Windows, we have on the GitLab a set of non-regression tests for the Linux part running in Docker, for the Windows part running thanks to AppVeyor. But regarding Zephyr, as we need to check the correct execution on some evaluation board, for instance, we did not have a solution for our continuous integration activity. But we have identified a solution thanks to the Redoubt framework. So for those who are not familiar with Renode, it is a product which is developed by Antmicro. It is also open source, and it can emulate some boards and you can perform some non-regression tests without the hardware. So instead of having this kind of boards on your desk, we have Renode on the GitLab to perform the continuous integration. So we have built a Docker image containing both all the Zephyr environment to compile the application binaries containing S2OPC plus the DIM application plus Zephyr, and Renode to set up configuration with several nodes. For example, here you can see that we have a configuration with two same A70 nodes. One of them is running a server plus a publisher. The second one is running a subscriber plus a server. So the publisher takes from the server some data to publish, and the subscriber push on the server the data which are received. And we have an external test module with an OPC UA client, which modified some data in the first application and check that these data are correctly received on the second one. So that's a mean to test and in continuous integration or deployment. This work is not still fully pushed on the GitLab, but it's a work in progress. As a trailer, you can see what is running right now. You have the two terminals. On the left, you have the first OPC UA publisher application, and on the right, the OPC UA subscriber application, both running inside the Docker and cross-checking their communication. So next step for Zephyr and S2OPC. The first one is to support additional boards by solving our last issues concerning the UDP multicast and setting up some additional nodes using Renode to perform some continuous integration. The second point we have identified will be to work on the time-sensitive network, because the OPC UA PubSub is a good protocol to communicate over time-sensitive network. And I know that some experiment has already been conducted using Zephyr on the subject, but it's not as advanced as on the Linux kernel, for instance. So it could be a good point to push on TSN. And another thing that we can do would be to communicate with OPC UA PubSub over MQTT. That's something we perform on Linux, for example. If we want to do this on Zephyr, we only need to bind to the Zephyr MQTT library instead of the one we are using on Linux. That's the Next step, we have identified so far on Zephyr, but we intend to continue pushing on the solution, because we think it's a solo. Zephyr and is really an operating system which will be very important for the future. That's all for my part. I have left 5 minutes, if I'm correct, for the questions. Do we have any questions so far?
If anyone has any questions, to put them in the chat and I'll read them out. Give people another minute or so and so question, what are the minimum system requirements for OPC UA? Is it stacked optimized and ported to Zephyr as the open source stack is quite big?
Yes, that's a very good question. You need to have some minimal requirement to have an OPC UA stack, especially if you perform the client server. If you want the full scope, server plus client plus pub, I would say that the minimum requirement will be 1 megabyte of RAM and 256 kilobyte of RAM. Below this level, yes, it's complicated. Whether you use open source or proprietary stack. If you only perform, for instance, the pub/sub mechanism, you can go far below than that. But you must take care that what is intended by the specification is that pub/sub module, if they want to access to their their keys for encryption and signature, they need to use an OPC UA client or a server so they can get their keys, or we can push their keys. One must be careful if you intend to design a system with only pub or sub. You can have several issues if you want to deploy cybersecurity. Does it answer your question?
I think so. And then I'll let him respond here while waiting. Yep. How does OPC UA compete compared to other protocols? What are its strengths?
I would say the one big strength of the OPC UA protocol is that it's highly interoperable. We can see a lot of other protocols which are standardized, but every vendor has made some tricky small modification, and with this modification, it's not interoperable, and there is a vendor lock. With the OPC UA, if you want to claim that you sell some OPC UA, you must go to the independent laboratory, and they perform some extensive testing on your product. So you can be confident if you purchase some certified OPC UA product, there is a 100% chance that they will communicate one with another. That's a big strange of OPC UA. I would say that compared to other protocol, the OPC UA protocol is more than a communication protocol. It's more can be compared to a technology, because not only define the way that you can communicate bits over the line, it defines the way you can model your system. You can be interoperable with each other using what we call companion specification. That means that the semantics of every data which is communicated between two machines, for example, for instance, there is a companion specification for robotics, and that means that two OPCUA products using this companion specification will have the exact same semantics for their command, for their actuators, and so on and so forth. So when you have a plant, you can replace easily one product with the other. In my opinion, it's far more than a protocol. It's a world technology, and it can be deployed from the sensor actuators to up to the cloud. That's why at the OPC Foundation, you will see some members which design some very small embedded system, as well as some PLC manufacturer, as well as some SCADA manufacturer, up to Google, Amazon, Microsoft, which are cloud provider, and can then connect their cloud solution directly to all OPCUA products.
Okay, and one final question. Can you explain that in the context of the difference between OPCUA and LWM2M?
I don't know the latter one.
Lightweight machine to machine, I think it is. I don't know. Yeah.
I'm sorry, I don't know this protocol. I don't want to invent something to fill it up.
So, well, thank you, Vincent.
You're welcome.
Okay. Thanks, everyone, and enjoy the rest of everyone's day.
Thank you very much. See you soon. Bye-bye.